will be celebrated for the repose of the soul of Dean Salpi and Marion Conway. Our opening song is Christ Be Our Light, number 683, Christ Be Our Light. Please stand.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ be our light, shine.
Do in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to our celebration for Mass on the fourth Sunday in Lent. Today the Church calls this particular Sunday Laetare Sunday. And so we adorn ourselves with rose vestments, which is a wonderful reminder that our Lenten obligations and disciplines are coming to an end, and that we might see the sun rise as it does reflected in our rose-colored vestments on our Easter morning. As we do always, we take a moment to call to mind our failings and our shortcomings, aware that this God who loves us brings us healing and forgiveness, and together we say,
I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned through my own fault, in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. And I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
God, the Father, mercies through the death and resurrection of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, has sent the Holy Spirit among us for the forgiveness of sins. Through the ministry of the Church, may God grant you pardon and peace, and I absolve you of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We offer our Mass today for the repose of the soul of Suzanne's cousin Anne, who went home to God suddenly. Almighty and eternal God, fill your church with the joy of the Spirit, that these elect, born once of earthly parents, may be born again to the new life in your kingdom. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, fill your horn with oil and set it out. I will send you to Jesse of Bethlehem, for I have provided myself a king among his sons. When the sons of Jesse came, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed is before the Lord. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look upon his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as the human sees. The human looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen any of these. Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? And he said, there remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep. Samuel said to Jesse, send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here. Jesse sent and brought David in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, rise and anoint him, for this is the one. Then Samuel took the horn of the oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want.
He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it is said, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The world, says the Lord. Whoever follows me will have the light of life.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. He spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then the man who was blind went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." They answered him, "You are born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Brothers and sisters, the good news of salvation, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
By the words of the Holy Gospel, may I send you Father.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I have a little fan in the front here. So welcome to our fourth Sunday of Lent. In so many ways, when we arrive at the fourth Sunday of Lent, the church gives us some signs. I'm using that particular noun intentionally, because the Gospel of John is the book of signs. This particular sign that we see in this Gospel is the sixth of seven, Next week it will be the raising of Lazarus. When you came in today, perhaps you noticed that the statues were covered. The church adorns ourselves in rose color, all to communicate visually that we are coming nearer and nearer to Holy Week and the Passion and the central mystery of our faith, which is the resurrection. So the church is encouraging us to get ready, right? Because it's all happening, right? Every year I begin Lent thinking, oh, it's a long way away, and then all of a sudden we're only 2 weeks away, right? Next 2 weeks is Palm Sunday, right? So in some ways, our Lenten disciplines, the church gives us this particular Laetare Sunday to hold on to the end, to stay faithful, to run the good race. And so that's what we're doing today. Yesterday, the parish participated in a day of reflection, a Lenten day of reflection. And one of our parishioners, Jim, gave us a wonderful discussion, or led us in a meditation and a reflection and discussion around the three arcs for ourselves that Lent might hold for us. But during the discussion, he spoke about ritual lacking understanding, perhaps might then dissipate how we participate in things in the church, right? So I thought that explaining a little bit about the rose vestments, about why we cover the images, but also what we're going to do today is the second of the scrutinies. Natalia, who has asked to be baptized in the church as an adult, has been preparing for that with Father Gidi all over this past year. And on the Easter Vigil, she will be baptized, chrismated, and communicated, all three at once, right? And so she has been preparing for that. And so what the church does is we involve ourselves in the scrutinies and exorcisms. It sounds a little, if you ever seen the movie The Exorcist, it's nothing like that, right? But in some ways, the rite of the scrutinies and the exorcism has been reestablished by the church after Vatican Council II. And the reason that we hear these particular Gospels, they're a little bit different than what your family is hearing in church for year B, but these three Gospels that we hear, last week it was the woman at the well, and Jesus reminds the woman and us that he is living water, that it is he that she seeks, right? And that's how we are satisfied. Today we hear in the scripture that Jesus is the light of the world. And maybe Natalia represents for us as adults who are more mature in the faith, our growing awareness of who Jesus is in our life. We can see in this particular Gospel of John, a little different than Mark, but this particular Gospel of John, the person who is healed of his blindness, is restored his sight, gradually comes to the understanding that it is the Messiah that has healed him. First he says he's a prophet, right, when he's challenged. And then, towards the end, when Jesus, when he's expelled from the synagogue, and Jesus goes to meet him, he says, "I am the Lord." And there is a sense that the restoration of his sight is not only physical, but it's spiritual, and that is for us as well. We hear in the beginning of this gospel, this man was from the time of his birth born blind. Right? That's also a device that John uses around light and darkness. That you and I, too, are born blind through the inheritance of our original sin. And it is through the gift of baptism and the graces that flow from that and our participation in the body of Christ that we come gradually sometimes to realize who Jesus is in our life and how that shapes the arc of our life. And so today we hear this particular gospel. And Natalia is reminded, and so are we, that Jesus is the light of the world, that he has come into the world to dispel the darkness, and no darkness can put it out. Next week, we're going to hear the raising of Lazarus. And we are going to be reminded that because of Jesus' death and resurrection, we no longer have anything to fear, that death no longer has any hold on us. And so today we celebrate the second of these scrutinies. I won't make you wait too long to tell you. But the idea of the scrutinies and the exorcism in the early church, especially those who were seeking to come to belong to the church, had to go through a period of initiation. They were initiates. And there was this kind of a little bit of caution in the Christian community because they were being persecuted. And so people coming to join the church, there was a period of getting to know each other. I think that's a good idea, right? right? When we get married, when we enter into important relationships, we take some time to get to know each other. Natalia has been doing that. She's been getting to know the Church Catholic through the experience of our participation here at St. Francis, right? You, for her, have become the tangible living body of Christ for her. And so after her baptism, you will become even more important as she participates in the mystagogia, which is the unfolding awareness of our faith as manifested by the people of God who are more mature in the faith. And so today, the scrutinies have been reestablished after Vatican Council II. And in the early days, they were a way of bringing the person into the community, into the body of Christ, by inviting them into real metanoia, real behavior change that results in their mind and in their heart. And so they would scrutinize the life of the person. And then they would say prayers. Sometimes it was done daily by the bishop. And then they would say a little prayer of exorcism. Exorcism is not the driving out of demons. It is request that all of the obstacles in our life might be removed so that we can move closer in our relationship to God through Christ and each other. The word scrutiny comes from the Latin and the French, and it means to be discerning, right? So when we scrutinize something, right, we look at it, what's important, what's not important, let me get rid of this, let me hold on to that. This process of scrutinizing is a way that we begin to discern what's important in our life and what is not important, and we can rid ourselves, especially in Lent. So when the Church first introduced these, they would do the scrutinies, and then they would do a prayer of exorcism, and then they would check in to see if the prayer of exorcism was working, to see, right, let's make sure that the prayer of exorcism is working, that you're growing closer and closer to God in prayer. In the restoration of this, we don't do it often, it's not often seen in parish communities, more so now, I think, but because of infant baptism, the rite of exorcism is right before, with infant baptism, it's about 3 minutes before we baptize the child, right? But this particular rite of exorcism and scrutiny is a way to involve Natalia as an adult in her appreciation of the faith and how we as Catholics live out that faith and express that faith. And so since the restoration of this, we do them together, the scrutinies and the rites of exorcism. And so today, Natalia is going to be admitted into the second of the scrutinies. We're going to pray that the light of Christ might come into her heart, that it might shine forth in you and I so that she might see a reflection of Christ and how you and I behave in the world. We will be her models for the incarnation of God's love in the world, right? St. Teresa of Avila reminds us that Christ no longer has any hands or feet or eyes. We need to be that for the people in the world, and we need to be that for Natalia, right? And so you, the parish community, who have supported her thus far in her journey. Maybe the heavy lifting will be done after the Easter Vigil, but then it is our responsibility to have her be included in the life of the Church in really important ways, and that she might see in us the sign of Christ living and dwelling in us as a parish community, but also in us individually. So we'll do that now with Natalia. I'll ask her to come forward. And I'll ask our sponsors, Mary, and John's going to stay there, but you can see him, right? So, yeah. If you would stand with me, please. Let us pray for Natalia, whom God has called, that she may remain faithful to him and boldly give witness to the words of eternal life.
And heart and preserve it always. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
that preferring the folly of the cross to the wisdom of the world, she may glory in God alone, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That freed by the power of the Spirit, she may put all fear behind her and press forward with confidence, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That, transformed in the Spirit, she may seek those things that are holy and just. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who suffer persecution for Christ's name may find their strength in him. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those families and nations prevented from embracing the faith may be granted freedom to believe the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we who are faced with the values of the world may remain faithful to the spirit of the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the whole world, which the Father so loves, may attain in the church complete spiritual freedom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church, that we may continue to grow in our relationship with Christ and manifest God's unbounded love for the human family by our deeds of light, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a greater realization of God's goodness, that we may recognize everything as a gift from God and open our hearts to accept the additional gifts that God has for us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are suffering, that God's unending love will bring health to the sick, food to the hungry, shelter to the homeless, jobs to the unemployed, and hope to those in despair, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who seek to grow in their faith, that Christ will reveal himself more and more to all who are preparing to receive sacraments this spring, and help them to live faithfully as children of the light. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our sister community, Holy Family Parish in Las Cruces, New Mexico, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are ill, that God will relieve their suffering, give them hope, and help many people to assist them. Are there any we should especially remember at this time? We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have died, particularly those who have died by violence or neglect, that they may experience the compassion and mercy of God who loves them. Are there any we should especially remember at this time?
Rocketta, Tommy, Ryan, Ginny, George.
We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And as always, we pray for those who have no one to pray for them. For them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father of mercy, you led the person born blind to the kingdom of light, to the gift of faith in your Son. Free Natalia from the false values that surround and blind her. Set her firmly in your truth, child of the light forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You don't have the advantage of seeing Natalia's face as we were praying those intercessions. But in so many ways, it's a great act of courage that she witnesses for us today, her desire to be a member of the body of Christ through the sacraments of the church. Lord Jesus, you are the true light that enlightens the world. Through your spirit of truth, free those who are enslaved by the father of lies. Stir up in them the desire of good for Natalia, whom you had chosen for your sacraments. Let her rejoice in your light that she may see. And like the blind man born blind, whose sight you restored, let her prove to be a staunch and faithful witness to the truth, for you are Lord forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
At this point, we would generally dismiss Natalia along with the other catechumenates, and so we're not going to do that. But what I will ask you to do along with her is to profess our faith as we say, we believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father. Through God all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Offertory song is Ashes, number 340, the hymnal Ashes.
Thank you.
my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours might be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all of God's church.
With joy, Lord, we present to you the sacrifice that brings us eternal healing. Grant in your goodness that we may celebrate this mystery with faith and offer it worthily for the elect. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By the mystery of his incarnation, he has led the human race out of darkness into the clear light of faith. Through the fall of Adam, we were born the slaves of sin, but through the waters of baptism, Christ has raised us to new life as your adopted children. And therefore, earth unites with heaven to sing a new song of praise. We too join with the host of angels as they proclaim your glory without end.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, God of might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
From the beginning, O God, all you have done for the human family, you have done for our good, that we may be holy as you yourself are holy. Look then with kindness on your people gathered before you. Send forth your spirit and power, that these gifts may become for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, in whom we have become your children, your sons and daughters. When we were lost and our hearts were far from you, you showed the depth of your love. Your Son, who alone is the just one, gave himself into our hands and was nailed to the wood of the cross. Before he stretched out his arms between heaven and earth in the everlasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover in the company of those he loved. While they were at table, he took bread. He gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, gave it to all of those whom he loved, and said,
Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you.
At the end of the meal, knowing that he would reconcile all things in himself by the blood poured out on the cross, he took the cup filled with wine. Again he gave you thanks and praise, and handing the cup to all of those whom he loved, he said,
Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me.
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
We remember Jesus Christ, our Passover and our lasting peace. We celebrate his death and resurrection. We await the blessed day of his return. And so we present to you, God, ever faithful and true, the offering that restores the world to your grace.
Merciful Father, look with love on those you draw to yourself through their sharing in the sacrifice of Christ. By the power of your Spirit, may they become the body of your risen Son, in whom all divisions are healed.
Keep us in communion of mind and heart, together with the patriarchs of Alexandria, Antioch, Constantinople, Jerusalem, and Rome, George, our bishop.
Help us to work for the coming of your kingdom until at last we stand in your presence and take our place among the saints, with the Virgin Mary and the apostles, and with all our departed sisters and brothers who we commend to your mercy. Then, in the glory of your creation, freed from the sting of death, we shall sing to you the hymn of thanksgiving, which rises from Christ the living Lord.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Father, in the words our Savior gave us,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin and protect us from all anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us love each other, a sign of Christ's peace. My sisters and brothers, this is Jesus, our Lamb of God. This is Jesus, the light of the world. This is Jesus who invites each and every one of us into the experience of God's love. And how happy are we to be called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be healed.
Please join the prayer for spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you again. Amen. A song during communion would be Amazing Grace, and I'm sorry I don't have the number. Six one four. Thank you.
Grace that taught
Let us pray. Sustain your family always, Lord God, and guide them along right paths. Keep them obedient to your will, and in your never-failing goodness, direct them toward eternal salvation. We make our prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you all for being here with us. Father Seamus, who you may know, but I couldn't help but to think about the signs of God's presence and healing grace in our life. And as you know, Father Seamus was very, very ill and has been almost completely restored to his health. But today, he was able to join us in praying the Mass with us because he has his glasses. So that was all right. He also told me before Mass that he'll be returning to work, so keep him in your prayers, but thank you for the prayers for his well-being. That's remarkable, right? The other thing I wanted to say, you can't possibly know sometimes, but our altar servers, Michael and Joyce, they are an unbelievable help to me. I often talk to Father Seamus about the vagaries of growing old, and I was doing the ablution with my hands. I was struggling a little bit with the cloth, and Joyce said, "You can do it, right?" So, right? and Michael and Joyce moved the books for me so that I might read better. So I'm very happy for that. And Colin, who joined John, these are like our Smothers brothers up here, right? So, yeah. Colin has no idea what references I make, none whatsoever. It's all good, though, Colin. It's all good. Thank you. And I love seeing the children in the church. This little one smiling at me all through Mass. That's what I was smiling at anyway. But I'm glad that you're here. Please join us as we move through our Holy Week. On Palm Sunday, we'll begin on the lawn with our procession. I think that right before that, there's a clergy retreat, so some of our clergy may be visiting with us, so please come and meet them. The Easter Vigil, we are privileged, one of our newer priests from Boston, Father Seamus. This is Father Seamus Primus, and now we have Father Seamus Secundus, right? So,
both from Boston.
Both from Boston. He's an accomplished musician, and so he's going to sing the Exultet for us. So please come so we won't bumble through the Exultet, hopefully, right? But join us, and then on Easter, with great joy, we'll celebrate the central mystery of our faith. So it's wonderful to see all you. And also, I just want to acknowledge, thank Jim for leading us in our day of reflection yesterday. But also, I want to thank Adam and Jim for getting on the ladder to cover the crucifix, right? Thank you, Adam. Thank you so much. Good. And I am reminded that yesterday was Mary Ann Lloyd's birthday. So if we could sing Happy Birthday, that would be great.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mary Ann. Happy birthday to you.
So the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Bow down for God's blessing. God of salvation, let your Son's passion and death be for your people protection from evil in this life, and the sure hope of glory in the life to come. Grant this through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go forth from this place in great peace and joy to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our song ascending forth is Save Us, O Lord, number 229. 229. Save Us, O Lord.